Today, I am joined by Mr. Alap Patel, Executive Director, Mr. Harsh Patel, Promoter Director, Mr. K.V. Unnikrishnan, CFO, and Mr. Nilesh Ganjwala, Senior Advisor to the company. I hope that all of you and your loved ones are safe. These are extraordinary times, and the most important thing for all of us is to ensure good health and well-being for ourselves and our near and dear ones. We have uploaded the investor slide deck and the results highlights on the stock exchange and company website. I do hope that everybody has had an opportunity to go through the same. The second wave of COVID-19 has adversely affected the economy and our company too. In these tough times, our priority was clearly to take care of our people who were working relentlessly in these challenging times. The company organized vaccination camps at the factories for the employees and their families. Everyone above the age of 45 has been vaccinated. More than 300 people in the range of 18 to 44 years have also been vaccinated at camps in our factories. We have also extended the health insurance program for all our employees. We encouraged people in the risk groups to work from home or offered them paid leaves. We facilitated hospital beds, critical medicines, and oxygen for any employee needing them, whether for themselves or their loved ones. During the peak of the second COVID-19 wave, the company facilitated the procurement of nearly 25 oxygen plants by hospitals in Surat and Navsari vicinity. Our know-how and relationship with manufacturers of the plant were used to help hospitals choose the right specification, negotiate the right price, get timely delivery, and have swift commissioning of the oxygen plants. In the background of these challenges, the company has recorded a 14% growth in revenues, a 25% growth in EBITDA, and a 36% growth in PAT for the full year ended March 2021. The company has a robust order book of over 6 months for both the divisions, filtration and drying equipment, and the glassline equipment. The delivery schedule continues to remain stretched, which shows the robust nature of the order flow and the sustainable demand. All the user industries, API, specialty chemicals, agrochemicals, dyes, and pigments are performing well, and their outlook remains promising in the coming years. Currently, the order book is well distributed across all the user industries. Coming to the filtration and drying business, HLE is the preferred supplier and the technology leader, having over 60% share in the Indian filtration and drying market. The HLE plant manufactures approximately 500 filters every year, the highest in the world. Today, the HLE brand is synonymous with filtration and drying in the Indian chemical and API industries, and is considered to be the industry reference for excellence in engineering. We constantly innovate and introduce new products and enhancements which are targeted at unmet customer needs. Currently, we are the second largest player in the Indian glass-lined equipment market. HLE Glasscoat is highly reputed for its quality, customer focus, and reliability. In this segment, the approach of the company is to increase the market share consistently through better product positioning and continuous product quality enhancements. We have the unique advantage of having the capability of supplying a bundle of products for all chemical process industries, which sets us apart from others. We have a diversified and well-balanced product portfolio. Agitated note filter dryer contributes 37% to our engineering equipment revenue, and agitated note filters contribute about 8%. Glass-lined reactor contributes 30%, while the contribution of glass-lined tanks is 16%. The remaining 9% comprises of other engineering products. Coming to our distribution and sales network, HLE Glascoat has a strong sales network across India and also globally. We have channel partners and sales offices in Europe, USA, Russia, Argentina, Israel, and Thailand. We have done plant installations in over 15 countries. Our approach remains to expand our reach in the market. We are also enhancing the after-sales business, which has excellent potential in the coming years. Our estimate is that there are over 6,500 of our filter dryers and over 60,000 of our glass-lined equipment presently operational in the various user industries. The focus on post-sales support for spares, components, and other services have the potential to add to the overall business. Being the industry leader, we are taking active steps to introduce newer technologies to smaller and medium-sized players in the chemical and pharma space. This will help us to increase our market share in this segment too. This market is growing rapidly. Seeing the increased demand for our products, the company is expanding quickly to meet the demands. During the last quarter, the company successfully commissioned the assembly shed at Anand, thereby enhancing the assembly capacity by around 50%. This will also add roughly 20% more floor space to the Anand workshop. The company has increased the capex plans for this year to ₹75 crores. The company is putting up a greenfield plant at Selvasa to augment filtration, drying, and other equipment manufacturing capacity. It is expected to be completed during financial year 2022. The aggregate project cost is estimated at ₹50 crores. This plant will also be equipped with a state-of-the-art machine shop. Installation of additional gas-fired furnaces is underway at the Anand facility. This will boost our glass-lined capacity by nearly 25% and reduce the per-unit power and fuel costs further. The new furnace is expected to be operational by Q1 financial year 2022. The aggregate project cost is estimated at ₹10 crores. The company has planned an addition of manufacturing shed adjacent to the existing facility at Maroli, adding over 25% more floor area for manufacturing of filtration, drying, and other equipment. The implementation is likely to be completed in around 9 months. The aggregate project cost is estimated ₹15 crores. With this, I would like to hand over the call to our CFO, Mr. K.V. Unnikrishnan, to discuss the financials for the quarter and the year gone by. Thank you. Over to Mr. K.V. Unnikrishnan.
Thank you, sir. Good evening and a very warm welcome. I hope that you are safe in this unfortunate pandemic, which has impacted one and all. Our company has reported a strong growth for the quarter and year ended 31st March 2021. The Board of Directors have recommended a final dividend of 4 per equity share of face value of rupees 10 each for the financial year ended 31st March 2021. Coming to the consolidated financials for the quarter, revenues have grown by 32% from rupees 113 crores in Q4 FY22, rupees 150 crores in Q4 FY21. Adjusting for the closure and winding down of the chemical business operation, as announced earlier, the total revenues have grown by over 52%. The company achieved revenues of rupees 71 crore from the filtration and drying business, a growth of 33%, and rupees 67 crores from the glass-lined equipment business, a growth of 78%. Overall, EBITDA of the company for the quarter stood at rupees 29 crores, a growth of 38%. Overall, EBITDA margins are at 19.2%, 80 basis points higher than last year. The company has earned healthy margins from both business, and the management remains committed to continuously improving our efficiencies, which will help to maintain and improve the margins going ahead. Profit after tax stood at rupees 18 crores, a growth of 63% during the quarter. This is despite the loss of rupees 2.02 crores incurred on the discontinuing chemical business. PAT margin stood at 12%, 230 basis points higher than Q4 FY20. Now, coming to the consolidated financials for the full year, revenues have grown by 14% to rupees 488 crores in FY21. This is despite the impact on sales in Q1 for the year due to lockdown in the country. Adjusting for the chemical business, which is winding down, the total revenues for the year have grown by 26% despite the pandemic impact. For the full year, the company achieved revenues of rupees 242 crores from the filtration and drying business, a growth of 21%, and rupees 200 crores from the grassland equipment business, a growth of 31%. Consolidated EBITDA for financial year 21 stood at rupees 96 crores, a growth of 25%. Profit after tax stood at rupees 53 crores, a growth of 36% during the year. PAT margin stood at 10.9%, 180 basis points higher than financial year 20. The company is continuously generating operating cash flows. For the year gone by, operating cash flows was a positive rupees 48.5 crore. With this, now we will open the floor for question and answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Dhaval Shah from Direct Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello. Hello, am I audible?
Yeah.
Yeah, hi sir. So congratulations to the entire team. So my question is on the ANFD business. So on a global scale, you mentioned we are one of the largest globally. Now the industry is quite well diversified in the Western markets. It's quite a mature industry there. So any sort of new competitive scenario coming up where those players would be thinking of coming and setting up their factories in India, given the large opportunity size?
I think it's a very good question. What has happened over the years is that the scale that HLE has been able to achieve is actually because of the unique situation in India. We can safely say that the growth of the filtration and drying products has been driven in a way by the way we have positioned ourselves and the way we have pushed product in the market. None of the mature markets have the scale or ever had the scale in terms of numbers, the scale that we have, not even China. So what is happening is that first, they don't have the competence, let me put it that way, to manufacture at this scale. And number two, because we have such a large market share and we have been continuously innovating, I think they have been in a way discouraged to even try. So there were one or two companies in the 90s and maybe in the 2000s, which were in collaboration with Indian companies for these products. And eventually both of them exited the Indian market.
Okay.
Our competitor who came to India, one of the bigger players in Europe who came to India, did not come with the filtration and drying products, but they came in with some other products merely because our market size in a way is too complex for them to manage. They already thought about that, and the fact that there is a very strong and technically competent player in the market.
Okay. So, sir, you mentioned about the scale point that none of the other markets globally have this scale as what India has. So scale is a factor of what? The certain kind of product which we have made here or the size of the chemical industry? Because size of the chemical industry is much bigger in China or maybe some other market compared to India. Or historically also India is just a fast growing market, but absolute size of Chinese market would be very large. So I just want to understand your scale point in a little bit more detail.
Definitely India is not the largest market for chemical products. But when I say scale, what we have done is that as actually we have been very successful in getting companies to adopt this particular technology, the ANF that we, the nose filter dryer that we say. So in terms of other markets, they have not adopted this technology to the scale that our Indian market has adopted. See, this product gives a lot of pharmaceutical companies a lot of advantages, which other alternative or competing technologies do not provide. One of the reasons that China, for example, as you pointed out, is not such a large adopter of this product or this technology is because the pharmaceutical industry, although very large, but for example, everybody knows that Indian market has the largest FDA approved plant. So when you have these kind of plants, you need sophisticated technologies like the filtration ANFD that we make. So basically the adoption of this particular technology is not to the scale that we have in India, in other countries.
So then it could also mean that your product could get a global patent sort of thing in terms of the what IP you have developed in-house, the technology what you have developed, and the kind of results what your customers are enjoying. So it's a very niche product and no one else can make it globally as on today.
That is not really absolutely true. These innovations are incremental and we cannot really get a patent. Also, the adoption is driven by the fact that we have been aggressively giving trials. We have been aggressively pushing product features which give small but incremental benefits. So these are not really things which can be patented. So this is more of a use the way we market and way we position ourselves in the market that has driven the volumes and the scale.
Got it. Thank you very much. I'll come back in the queue.
Thank you. Participants who wishes to ask a question may press star and one now. To ask a question, please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Abhishek Datta from Prabhudas Lilladher. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Congrats on a great set of numbers. Sir, I just wanted to know, where do you see the with so much opportunities across specialty chemicals, agrochemicals, and pharma, where do you see the revenues and profitability at least 3 to 5 years down the line for the company?
The opportunities are actually, if you see our distribution, number distribution, they usually, historically we have had high revenue or high percentage of pharma revenue in our basket. Last 2 years have been slightly different, where the pharma share has dipped a little bit. That is not because that the pharma market has grown slower. It is simply because other markets have other customer segments have done better. So your question was, where do we see the growth? Is that your question?
No, sir. What I mean that there is growth across all the segments where you are present in. What I mean to say is that from current turnover of around 400-500 crores, where do you see the company 3 to 5 years down the line in terms of revenue and profitability? That's what my simple next question is.
I see we see continued growth. I think our growth obviously is driven by by the growth of the user industry. And we currently see growth happening across all industry users, whether it be API pharma, which is now catching up speed, then agrochemicals continues to be strong. Specialty chemicals has also had a great period in the last couple of years, and the order flow is very, very robust. So we believe that with all these areas of all the user industries doing well, our growth is obviously aligned to their growth prospects. Secondly, there is also the winds across the globe in terms of realignment of the supply chains. And this is adding a very different element of growth, which is structural in nature across all of these industries. And last but not the least, of course, the government incentives are also playing a very positive role. And we believe that that will probably drive the market up further in the next couple of years. So we do believe that what we are seeing is just the beginning of a large wave of growth for industries such as ours.
Per annum?
Sorry, I didn't get that question.
Can we expect a strong growth of over 20% CAGR over next few years then, given the strong tailwinds which you are enjoying?
So, I think as we mentioned probably in the previous call as well, I think over at least the next 3 years, if we achieve anything less than 20%, we will be disappointed.
Okay. And sir, secondly, on this glass-lined equipment, you have currently 30% market share. And so what will be the unorganized share in this pie?
Yeah. So in the glass-lined market, I think the two biggest players put together have over an 80% market share. There are a couple of smaller players in the industry. Their market share is anywhere between 50 and 20%.
Okay, sir. So, can did you mention the order backlog for the company per se? And because I missed that, I joined a bit late. Can
I? Yep. So, for both the businesses, our order backlog is still in excess of 6 months. So we have maintained the order backlog.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much and all the best, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ayush Mittal from Mittal Analytics. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, team HNE. First of all, congratulations on a good performance in recent times. I have a couple of questions. So, one, can you quantify the value of the order book that we have? Because if we see the presentation, it has been mentioned that 6 to 7 months in this presentation, and it was the same 6 months back also. While if we see in the industry, there has been very large CapEx announcements, like you just mentioned in your comments. So have we seen increase in order book? If not, why?
So we are seeing an order book which is quite good. It is growing quarter on quarter. The current order book in terms of overall value is approximately 240 crores.
And I believe in the 6 months back also it was somewhat a similar number?
Yeah, 6 months back it was, I believe it was around 225 crores. That's correct.
Okay, okay. So is it that as the companies go forward with their CapEx plans, that is where they place orders, or how is that order flow happens to the company? At what stage do we get those orders? And
so actually, the order flow is not a simple number that we track, because we also would obviously like to look at the pipeline of orders, which is the orders under negotiation. And as long as the pipeline is strong, orders are only a culmination of that pipeline. So as long as we have a strong pipeline of inquiries, we believe that at least the immediate future or the foreseeable future at least looks good. As I probably said this before, the API pharma market, which had a slight dip in terms of percentage share, is now catching speed, and we believe that that will be the next driver of growth within the overall user segments.
Okay. Second, we see that the steel prices and those things have risen a lot. So how does it impact us? Have we been able to increase the prices? If you can share something on this front.
Yes. So as you know, you very rightly said, and as is you know, known to all of us, the commodity prices have gone up substantially over the last couple of months. You know, while we have been able to price in the increase in commodity prices to a certain extent, we do have a certain window between which we quote to a customer and the time when the order is finalized. So, you know, some of the price increases that happened during this window are likely to have an impact on the margins. Everything else other than that, that margin impact would generally be very low, because as a strategy and as a policy of procurement, we charge our customers in advance and use that to hedge our material costs.
Yeah, I get that point. What I'm trying to understand is that given the price increase in steel and raw material, can you share the quantum of price increase that you are taking or something?
Would be difficult to quantify specifically, but I think in general, the overall cost increase is being passed on to the customers. Of course, the quantum of increase in carbon steel and in stainless steel, etc., is different. So across product segments, the price increases will differ.
Okay. Okay. So also, like you mentioned that in India, you don't, like across the globe, you don't have too much of competition when it comes to the products you are manufacturing, as you have some edge and differentiation. So what kind of possibility do we have on the export side, and are we trying to expand our geographical reach?
There is India, many countries are now also adopting China plus policy. So we have seen great traction from the developed markets in the last few months, and we are many orders and inquiries are in the pipeline, which are higher than they used to be, say 1.5 or 2 years before. So yes, we expect the good growth on the export side as well.
Okay.
If
okay.
I may
thank
add,
you. That's
the main constraint in tapping the export market today is actually the high level of demand in the domestic market. So obviously, our priority currently is to meet domestic demand, which itself is, as we said, there are. Time constraints on schedule and delivery constraints. So while we have an established presence in the export market, we are not able to grow that market simply because of the robust nature of the Indian market.
Okay. And like in your last call, you also explained that these products are like very customer specific with some customization, and they bring a lot of efficiency and value addition to the customer. So obviously there has to be a much bigger global market also. So what steps are we taking to expand our market reach and growth things?
So I think we have, Himanshu Bhai has explained in his speech that, you know, we have agents all over. We also have a few offices or rather agents who are acting as our offices in a few countries. We are also participating in various exhibitions. Unfortunately, this year and the year before that, that was not possible. So we are making a lot of use of the internet, but basically mainly through our agents and our offices across the globe.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ronak Vora from EHM Advisor. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Congratulations on a good set of numbers. So in the glass line segment, currently, So how is the demand that you're seeing in the Indian markets in the pharma space, and what kind of runway do you see for the next 5 years? And plus, I believe that exporting in Asian countries should be quite simple for us with the kind of reach that we currently have and the kind of the branding that we do.
Can you repeat the last sentence? I could not get the last couple of sentences.
So I was saying that, I think that exports should, give a good runway for us, looking at the kind of brand image that we have in export markets. And, and I believe that looking at the domestic demand, don't you feel that we should diversify from the domestic demand?
Yeah, I think we are not ignoring the export market at all. What came about. But right now the growth in the domestic market is very high. We are of course addressing the export market to the best of our capability. And that is also one of the reasons that we have such large expansion plans, which Himanshu Bhai explained in his speech. So we are definitely going to address this in the coming months.
Okay. Secondly, sir, what kind of capacity do we have in the glass line segment in terms of tubes that...
In terms of what did you ask?
I think it's your competitor mentioned it as equivalent units in terms for the glass line capacity. So EUs, that is what I said.
So, we don't quantify measure our capacity in terms of, something of the sort of equivalent unit. Because I think the value of a glass line equipment or a capital equipment like ours really depends on not just the size, but the specifications and the different kinds of value additions that you can have on a single equipment. So, just for example, a 6 point or a 6,300 liter vessel, just a plain reactor, the cost will be substantially lower than a 6,300 liter vessel that is, meant for the pharma industry, is, CGMP compliant, has a lot of add-ons, including temperature sensing, tantalum tips, etc. So, the value could be substantially different. So I think it's not the capacity of the plant. It's not really meaningful to define it in terms of EUs.
Can you just help us, how many gas furnaces do we have as of currently, or blast furnaces, whatever it is?
Yeah. So right now we have 5 furnaces for manufacturing of the equipment.
Okay.
So when I say equipment, it's the main body of the reactor or the tank. Out of that, 1 is gas-fired. We are shortly about to commission our 2nd gas-fired furnace, which will be the 6th furnace for equipment in our workshop. In addition to the furnaces for the main job, we also have 5 furnaces dedicated for manufacturing of or for glass lining of components. So when I say components, they are things that are installed inside or on the reactor.
Okay, sir. And sir, any guidance for the next 1 year, 2 year, with kind of what revenue growth and margins would be? See, assuming that I think we have a 6 month order backlog, I think 30% should be the minimum guidance that you should get.
So, as we said earlier, any growth of less than 20% will be disappointing. We are hoping to maintain the same growth trajectory that we have shown over the last couple of years.
Okay, sir. And would the same margins be sustained at 20%?
we are hopeful that yes, we will sustain the margins. Of course, there could be some blips here and there, predominantly like things like, let's say, the pandemic, over which we really don't have control, or some spikes in material prices here and there. So by and large, yes, I think otherwise the business and the margins are on track.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants who wishes to ask a question may press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Kaushal Shah from Dante Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir, and congratulations to the entire team for the great performance. Sir, I had a few questions. One was, our quarterly run rate in the March quarter has been, really superb. And we have done one of the best performance, I think. And this is, even before majority of our capex is going to be commissioned. So you mentioned that Anand has just been commissioned. The glass line is underway. Even Maroli is underway. And of course, Silvassa is also underway. So just wanted to get a, little clarity on, this quarterly run rate. How much that can increase? Because obviously, a lot of our capex will get commissioned over the next 9 months, 12 months, both Maroli as well as Silvassa. So that was the first question. The second question was on, capex after that, in the sense, I'm presuming that Silvassa being greenfield, we will have ample opportunity to do a brownfield over there. But given that our order book just now is around 6 months, do we anticipate, some further capex in the next year, to kind of either trim this capex or even what Himanshu sir mentioned about, taking the export opportunity. So maybe, if we want to kind of expand our horizons more. So some thoughts on that.
Sorry, I'll take your question in chronological order. So just to give you a little history, in February 2019, we commissioned the additional gas line for first gas-fired furnace, which added capacity. During the last financial year, we added the assembly shed. Both of these were in the glass lining business. And so that was commissioned somewhere in quarter three of FY21. The new furnaces, the gas-fired furnaces, both for the main body as well as for the components, are getting installed as we speak and probably will be commissioned in the next 2 or 3 weeks. So that will give an additional production capacity in the glass line business. In the filtration and drying space, we are adding more space and manufacturing area in the Maroli plant, which is already a project under implementation. We believe that this project can be commissioned within the next 6 to 9 months. So that will add further capacity to the filtration and drying. We have also, looking at the future, commissioned the new greenfield project at Silvassa, for which we have bought land, keeping the next 7 to 10 years of potential expansion in mind. So while it's a greenfield project, it's an area which we know very well. It's also a place where we have our team because we also own 99% of HL equipment, which is currently manufacturing in Silvassa. So we have both the knowledge of the ground realities as well as the management team available there to quickly ramp up the business in Silvassa. So I think we are taking steps to progressively increase capacities both in the glass line business as well as in the filtration and drying area. To answer your other question with respect to potential capex going forward, I think we've always maintained that our capex will not be big lumpy capex programs. We will always do a more phased capex, which will be directly connected with our let's say knowledge of how the market is progressing, and hence you may have noted also that over the last 4 years we've already done about 4 or 5 expansion plans. So this is something that we believe is a part and parcel of our growth strategy, and yes, as the market grows and evolves, we are more than happy and ready to put in additional capital expenditure to increase capacities. On the export front, we believe that it's a great buffer for us that should there be a quarter or two where domestic demand doesn't match up, the export demand is still a very nice buffer for our growth in the coming years.
Great. This was very helpful, Nileshbhai. Thank you so much. So just one question on the capex front. I mean, typically, can we kind of pencil in maybe around 50-odd crores of likely capex in the next year, 23, you know, presuming we could add maybe one more gas furnace or, do something either at Maroli or maybe even in Anand to kind of, add that additional capacity that you were talking about. So typically, will that number be more or less correct?
Well, it's a little bit of a futuristic question, but typically one round of expansion, either at Maroli or Anand, has at least traditionally been in the 10 to 15 crore range for us because, the way we have built our facilities and the way we are building our future capacities in a phased manner actually enables us to keep us at probably the lowest capex on a per unit basis. So I think this is that could be kind of an estimate of an expansion, the phase-wise expansion that we've done in the past. So maybe between 10 to 15 crores per location.
Okay. And one question on the balance sheet. As on date March, we had some debt on our books. But obviously, the business is ramping up and we also have money from the QIP flowing in. So do you anticipate that debt number, the absolute number, to kind of remain fairly constant or we can look at some repayment over the next, let's say, 12 months to maybe 15 months?
I would definitely expect the debt to be lower for two reasons. One is, of course, we've had an additional infusion from the warrants, and in fact, we've had an additional flow of 40 crores, which has come in the month of May 2021, which has obviously reduced our net debt position. And secondly, I think we are also in the fortunate position where the operating cash flows are positive. Not just positive, they're quite robustly positive. So because given this scenario, I would definitely expect the debt position to improve in the coming months.
Great. And just one last question on the working capital front. Do we anticipate, given the higher level of operations, we have all of these plants getting commissioned over the next, let's say, like you mentioned, 6 to 9 months, and then Silvassa also maybe towards the later part of the year. Do we anticipate working capital to be roughly maintained at the current levels in terms of number of days, or there could be some, maybe some deterioration, if I can use that word, just to kind of, sustain the higher level of operations?
In our view, the working capital situation for 2000 or during FY21 was actually a little bit of a abnormal scenario, given that a lot of companies have basically using the pandemic as a reason chosen to negotiate their credit periods. I don't think this will last in the coming months going forward. So we actually believe that the actual customer outstanding position should actually improve on a number of days basis, and that will substantially improve our overall working capital cycle. To answer your question, I think growth will probably not have a pro rata increase in working capital going forward. It probably be less than pro rata increase in working capital.
Great. This was very helpful. So I'll join back in the queue. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ronak Vora from OHM Advisor. Please go ahead.
Hi, I had a few more questions. So
With the kind of gross stock that we have and the capex that we are doing, what kind of asset turnover can we see?
As I just mentioned, our capex on a per unit basis is probably the lowest in the industry, and we've consistently shown that despite capex programs being put in place over the last couple of years, our asset turnover ratios have actually not worsened. If anything, they've actually improved. So the high capacity utilization of the existing assets combined with the low capex for the additional capacity buildup, I think given these two situations, we do not believe asset turnovers will deteriorate. In fact, we are hoping that they will improve.
Okay, sir. Sir, on the pricing front, when we say that, we have the second market share, so in terms of glass lined equipment, do we see any pricing difference between us and the first player? So in terms of quality, and do we sell at a discount or do we sell at par? So what kind of situation are we in?
I think we are in a competitive market where both the players have a market share that is not substantially different. And I think we often compete in the market on price as well. So, when I say that, I think, there are a lot of instances where our competitors win a project based on price. So, the competition happens not only on price, but, there are certain projects where we are better suited to deliver faster. There are other factors like other than price, there is always questions of delivery, relationship with the customer, so on and so forth. So on an overall basis, I would say that there is really no difference in the pricing that is commanded by either of the players.
That means that assuming that our quality is equal to a competitor, our pricing is also at par. But it always depends on the relationship with customers and the delivery schedule that we can provide. Correct?
Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kaushal Shah from the Anti Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks, sir, for the opportunity. Sir, I had two questions. One was, now that the chemical business is kind of getting wound up, if you can, help me with what is the likely share of that chemical business in our, networks? What would be the likely share?
I didn't get the question because I think the network will just get used in the other business. So I do not believe that the network is lost.
Okay.
So as I think we had probably stated in the earlier call, the purpose of winding down the chemical business was predominantly A, because it was not logical and feasible to continue the business at that location, and also because we wanted to use the same premises for expanding the filtration and drying business. In fact, as we speak, after the dismantling of the chemical plant, the expansion of the Maroli unit is happening in that specific area. So,
correct.
Yeah, so basically, what was, let's say, land used for chemical plant will now become land used for filtration and drying plant.
Sure. Okay. And some color on, the off-the-shelf products that you had, which were, you were addressing to the MSME or the SME segment. So any, now that, we have sufficient capacity coming up over the next in the ANFD field, do you think we can ramp up that particular part of the business?
Yes, I think we are very bullish on that product segment. We have been very optimistic and positive about that particular market as well. So, you know, we have always maintained that we are, you know, present only amongst the, maybe, you know, to begin with, we were with only the top 100 or 200 players, you know, manufacturers of chemicals and pharmaceutical products. With the introduction of these products, we are now with around the top, maybe let's say 500 companies manufacturing chemicals. We hope to penetrate that market further and further. And I think we have already seen a substantial amount of success with this. You know, just as an example, in the financial year 2020-21, we sold anywhere between 180 to 190 filter dryers in this segment, which compared to the year before that, it was only about 125. And, you know, if you go even further, maybe the year before that, it was 90, 50, so on and so forth. So we have seen substantial amount of growth in that market, and we are very optimistic about that segment even going forward.
Great. This was very helpful, Alapai. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. As this was the last question for today, I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Himanshu Patel for closing comments.
I take this opportunity to thank everyone for joining in on the call. I hope we have been able to address all your queries. In case you require any further details, you may please contact us or Mr. Devin Dhruva from Orient Capital, our investor relations partner. Thank you very much to all.
Thank you. On behalf of HLE Glassco Limited,